poor thing. But no, but Executive Superintendent Watts, it's wonderful to have you here. And we really appreciate your support. One of my students, Annie, is here right now, actually. So hi, Annie, how are you?
Hi.
Good. Annie goes to Staten Island Tech.
Oh, okay. Hi, Annie.
Yeah. Hi.
And Annie was one of the developers of the PowerPoint we'll be using in this series. So we want to thank her for that. It'll be, Annie, your PowerPoint will live on for multiple series because we'll probably focus on Satanji Agosa today and her journey through Duke and beyond. But have no fear that your presentation will make an appearance today and next time as well. So Executive Superintendent Watts, what are you up to these days, by the way?
You know, we always have something cooking, something great for our students. Yep. Oh, we just came off the most wonderful Black History Month. We had a wonderful Lunar New Year celebration on Thursday. Awesome, awesome work from our students all across Brooklyn North. Tremendous work by the staff. Everybody's just stepping up and giving, you know, elevating the voices of our students, elevating the voices of our parents. So a lot of wonderful things.
That's wonderful. Yeah.
So I'm really excited about that as I reflect on February this morning.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Yes, absolutely. I've been involved in a number of Black History Month events, and it's been really fabulous to be involved with them and do some.
No, I'm still trying to process one that I experienced yesterday. Mm-hmm. In addition to speaking with Stedman Graham,
was that really Stedman Graham? Like Stedman Graham?
Yes, like, in person. Yeah.
I saw that. I was like, is that Stedman Graham? Like, maybe that's some other person who like named their child Stedman Graham.
So in addition to that, I went to this celebration in District 32. That was phenomenal. Wow. And they had something called the Shades of Beautiful. And they spoke about humans, you know, the evolution of humans across the planet.
Yes.
And with an emphasis on H-U-E. Human and the various colors and how we all ended up with these different colors and shades of human beings. I'm still getting goose pimples. I need to get that. I don't know where they got it from. I just happened to go to that event yesterday.
Wow.
Amazing perspective.
That's incredible. That is incredible. I love it.
Yes. Yes. So I really need to share that across Brooklyn North. I need to get that video digested a little bit more. I'm telling you,
it was exciting. Awesome. No, I saw it and I was just like, what? I think I'm like, I didn't even really know he did stuff like besides just smile next to Oprah. I had no clue. But
he's
he does.
A motivational speaker, I think. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Right. But he's got a whole life that we don't really know about, you know? So, wow.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm jealous. But when you get that tape, I would love to see it. So, I want to introduce you to Satanji Agosa. So Satanji is the chief of staff for Assemblyman Charles Fall here in Staten Island. So Satanji, we have Executive Superintendent Karen Watts here. She is the Executive Superintendent for Brooklyn North Schools. So she has over 200 schools, maybe even more in her realm, in her fiefdom. And maybe each of you could introduce the other. And we're expecting some more students, but maybe Executive Superintendent Watts, if you could tell Satanji who you are, and then Satanji, if you could tell Executive Superintendent Watts who you are, I think that'd be wonderful.
All right. Good morning, Satanji.
Good morning.
Yes. Yeah, so I've been a longtime educator here in New York City, teacher, principal, superintendent, and now executive superintendent of Brooklyn North. That is the largest executive superintendency with 8 districts. districts 13, 14, 15, 16, 19, 23, and 32, and the high schools in those districts, and 235 schools, 108,000 students. And it is my honor to serve the students of Brooklyn North. We lead with hope, love, and science. We've had a vision around eSTEM, or equity through STEM education, that we've now just morphed into science with what's going on around the country. So I think our theme of hope and love has really supported us throughout the pandemic, throughout the social unrest that's happening. And now will lead us into healing as we go into the 21-22 school year and beyond. And of course, with the new chancellor, so that's all very, very exciting. And so, yes, so that's a little bit about me.
Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. It's wonderful to meet you. And good morning.
Yeah. Hi.
So yeah, thank you for, you know, for introducing yourself. My name is Satanji. I'm the chief of staff to Assemblyman Fall, the first Black and Muslim representative to represent Staten Island in the Assembly. I've been in this role going on 3 years. This is the third year now. I am a product of public school education out here in Staten Island. Before going off to college at Duke University, which I'm excited to talk about that process today with all the young students that join on today. I studied public policy and global health, and then shifted that into a lot of work in government space, interning with the Mayor de Blasio's office under Deputy Mayor Palacio. And just doing as much community engagement work as I can, and campaigning over the past couple of years, that's allowed me to really get to know and better understand the neighborhood of the North Shore, which I grew up in. So it's really exciting to, you know, one, be a part of an office that is working to actively support what is a Black, majority Black and Brown community on in the North Shore, but also just a diverse place with a lot of diverse issues and developments that are occurring right now. So thankfully I met Heather through some programming in the community, lots of different things that we've gotten to do together and hopefully continue to do together, most recently being a neighborhood cleanup at a Van Pelt.
The massage students are doing that. That's the
I know. Yeah.
Right. Exactly. Yes.
And I want to, again, kind of speak to you, Heather, in this one, and just that we do want to really connect with the youth. It's been quite a whirlwind of a past couple of weeks, and we can talk offline. But the massage students are real, so amazing in terms of what they presented to me, at least, and already on the other project they've done, as well as the work that they're looking to do, or even just engage the community in for that lot site. So it's been an exciting time. So obviously, you know, it's been difficult couple of past a year now for the communities, but that, you know, our role is to step up and support them however we can. So it's been
excellent.
They're doing such an incredible job, and Executive Superintendent Watch, you should see the detail that's going into this, but we're not going too much into detail because we still want to get the input from the community and what they think. So, you know, essentially this project is a little different than some of the others because of that. So it's super interesting and super exciting, but they're building into it. They're building into the vacant lot project, the aspect of it that will involve community input and outreach. So it's awesome. It's great.
Oh, but that's something that the students at WSSAD are accustomed to, right? Involving the community, working with the community, recently going to doing the work with Lake Como. I think, was it last June that I went to the council meeting?
Yes.
Yeah, so, you know, I'm so proud of the students at WSSAD. Just so that Satanjay, I don't know how much you know about that school. It's a school that's not screened in any way. Mm-hmm. It has a diversity in an admissions program, right? Any student that walks through the door is welcome there. And it's a school that has a graduation rate of 98% or something like that. Wow. Phenomenal work. The project-based work that happens at that school is unbelievable. Mm. Every student is activated and involved, and every student gets to develop their talents and reach their highest potential at that school. It's an example of what every school can be.
Yeah.
Right? Diverse, no screening, inclusive, everyone is there, and so on. You know, everyone is welcome there.
That's beautiful.
But the work is still rigorous, right? And so on. So it's just, you know, when I envision working with my 231 schools, and we're hoping to put on, we have a One Brooklyn TV channel, and we're hoping to put on a series led by students called Every School is a Great School. That's going to be the series. Mm-hmm. Because the thing is, we have, you know, we only hear about certain schools, but we have almost every, for me, I'm biased, every single one of the 235 schools that I have in my portfolio is a great school, right? Every seat is a great seat in those schools, right? Whether those schools are specialized, screened, have G&T programs, or just a regular neighborhood school, what we try to do there is provide opportunities for every single one of the students. We want to ensure that every student feels that the school that they're attending was designed for them and them only, right?
Yes.
They have everything that they need at that school to be successful. And Heather has been a great partner in helping us design schools like that.
I believe me, partners like yourself and Tatanji make it extremely easy to do this kind of work. I've been working with WSSAD for several years now, and it's just, it's a pleasure cruise to work with them, and the kind of focus that the teachers and Principal Cornell and all of the APs do there, it's unbelievable. So they make it very easy, and it's lovely to hear such kind things about the school, because they really deserve it, and you know, they've earned it. And the fact that they're doing work in Staten Island, for example, when it's, you know, it's not their borough, but they're reaching out, it really shows you the scope and the breadth and the depth of how much that school wants to be a part of the entire New York landscape. Mm-hmm. So it's a testament to those students and the principal in that school that they're doing that kind of real on the ground work. And they're proud of themselves.
What I like to call real. You know, there's something with in education where we talk about exposing students to real life situations, problems, and so on to solve. It's one thing to have that exposure to maybe work on it within a classroom, but it's a totally different thing to then go out into the community and implement whatever the solution is that you came up with, and so on. And I think that even brings it to a whole different level. So I appreciate all the opportunities that Heather brings to WSSAD students to be able to do those kinds of projects.
And you know, it all links in with this college readiness workshop, and it all links in with you know, this kind of work, because you know, when we think about what makes for a student that will be able to present themselves in a way, I think we have one of our Detroit students on. That's great.
Hi, oh, really?
Yes, we have one student. How are you?
Hi, I'm here with Oscar.
Oh, that's awesome. Hello. Hey, Oscar, how are you? So Oscar is one of our students from Detroit. He does our virtual soccer program. And he came to us, he just found our program randomly online and started showing up for our virtual soccer. And now we have a whole crew of students from Detroit that participate in our program. And we also do robo soccer, which we're gonna do in a little while. So Oscar is the Detroit contingency.
And all made possible because of technology, right?
We would have all made possible because of technology. That, by the way, that's what's making the Lake Como project that we're continuing to do possible. That's what's making all of the Staten Island projects with WSSAD that we're doing still possible, our virtual soccer, our robo soccer. Absolutely right. So, I mean, I know COVID is, you know, devastating in so many ways, but one thing it's shown us is that technology can be a pathway forward to be able to get some of what we weren't doing before. I mean, I think everybody talks about, oh, why can't we get back to the old good old days of 2019? It was so great. Well, one, it wasn't that great for everybody. Like, everybody wasn't living their best life in 2019. And two, even though some people had the resources they needed and they were doing fine, a lot of people didn't have those things. And so, you know, to me, I always look at this time as an ability to be able to think as far reaching as one can about the possibilities and the people that we left behind in 2019, because we left a lot of people behind in 2019, and hopefully we can start to get them to be part of this. But yeah, technology has been the way for us, to be honest with you. It really has been. Mm-hmm. So we've done a lot. Health for Youth is busier now than we've ever been by exponentially by a ton. We're doing so much more now than we've ever been able to do ever. So it's incredible.
All right. Well, nice spending some time with you this morning.
You too. Thank you so much. And you got to take off. I totally understand it. We're going to keep taping. We got some more kids coming in, but you have the dates through June, and we're going to keep rolling it along, okay?
All right. And also, can we connect? I'm going to have Precious connect us. I have an idea I want to discuss with you to see if you can help in any way.
I'm all about ideas.
All right. Thanks, Heather.
Thank you. And bye.
It was great connecting with you. Nice meeting you.
Bye.
Okay, nice meeting all of you. Have a happy Saturday morning. All right. Take care.
Bye.
Great. All right, I'm taping this just so we have it, so I hope that's okay with everybody. Okay, so hi everybody. So I think we're gonna get going with the session, and here we are with the fabulous, amazing, awesome Sataji Agosa. So I think what we should first do is have you introduce yourself. Tell the students a little bit about who you are, what you do, all that good stuff. And then I thought we would ask a series of questions. Our student Annie Leong put together an amazing presentation. We may hold it to the next session just because, in the interest of time and all that good stuff, we're gonna try to end at 11 to honor people's time. I think it would be great to be able to hear a little bit about who you are and what you do and how you do what you do and all that good stuff. So take it away.
Okay. For the record again, I'm Sataji Agosa. I am a Staten Island resident, born and raised in Mariners Harbor. I'm currently serving as the Chief of Staff to Assemblyman Charles Fall on the North Shore, 61st District. In the state assembly, I've been in this role. He's been in office since 2019. Sorry. 2019, before that, I had studied at Duke University, got a degree in public policy and global health, and then had done previous work in the mayor's office under Deputy Mayor Palacio, interned at a school actually in the city, Harvest Collegiate, to learn about kind of some of their efforts to do restorative justice work. So just always been about kind of community building and engaging different interest areas for me, a lot of that being education and health for young women and people of color. I'm really excited to be here with you guys today to talk more about just that process of going to college and what that looks like for a young person today, and how to make informed and educated next step because it is a difficult process. It is one that can become overwhelming, depending on you know, what the support looks like for you. But I think it's also a very empowering process if you allow it to be, because it really is about learning yourself and then making decisions based on what you think, what institution or program or fellowship, if you don't necessarily go down a traditional school route, could offer you an opportunity to grow as a young person. I went into college at 17. Because I started school young. So I went into college, left my family, went to North Carolina at 17. And that was a eye-opening experience, but it was one that, because I chose a school that I felt would be supportive, was the best decision for me. And I would do it again. So I'm, you know, hoping to be here as a resource to all of you, both today and moving forward. So you can just learn about what that looks like to go to college and how it feels to make that decision confidently.
Awesome. Okay, great. So what I thought we would do would be to just kind of go down a few questions. And then for the student, if you have any questions and you wanna add anything, feel free to put it in the chat and we will ask them. And if you wanna take yourself off mute and ask questions, feel free. And Oscar, you're on the younger end of things. So if you have questions or your mom has questions, you know, please don't hesitate to ask them. So as we're going along, put questions in the chat. We'll try to end at 10:30. We'll try to end at 11, which we could go to 10:30 tomorrow, but we'll try to end at 11. As we're going along, if you have questions, feel free to ask them. So, number one, maybe you could talk to us a little bit about when and how you started to prepare for college.
Mm-hmm. I think, again, this is now me at least, how many years removed? about 7 or maybe 8 years removed from that process. But so bear with me if I have to jump back to points and be like an oh yeah moment. But essentially, I think for a lot of you, particularly those who are maybe juniors, you know, a lot of that begins with taking another standardized exam, which is the SAT, or what's the alternative? If you're not taking the SAT, you can take what's the other exam?
Oh, ACT?
ACT, yes. So choosing between those was kind of the first step for me in terms of deciding, you know, getting a test score that I felt at first just to understand the test and then, you know, kind of try and hope for my best. So I, you know, did a lot of in my school. Thankfully, I went to school in Staten Island. They offered some of those free after, maybe it wasn't free, but a course after school where you could, you know, stay for a couple extra hours and begin your prep. So that was kind of my first introduction into that. I didn't know what score I was shooting for. I was kind of just, you know, shooting into the dark. Hey, let's take this exam, try and do our best. And from there, go forward. So I took the, SAT, that was the one that I had studied for. I think I was in that course for about a couple of months after school every other day, and then took the exam. And I think my score was okay. You know, I don't think it was, you know, out of this world, but it wasn't terrible. But I think, you know, as many of your guidance counselors probably let you know, you can take it a couple of time, another time or two before kind of making decisions. But once I had that test score, I could start to wrap my head around where I was at, what maybe schools were in my zone of, you know, of reach, what if I wanted to get out of that zone and reach any further, what scores I needed to get. So taking that exam, I think, was my first introduction even to thinking about college. But that's not always everybody's approach, right? You can start to think about what schools you want to go to first, and then, you know, understand what those requirements are, and then apply that to how you would approach your test. But regardless, I think that was my first step, taking the exam. I ended up taking the SAT twice and the ACT once. It was SAT, ACT, SAT. And I thought my ACT was better than my ACT was better than my first SAT. So I was like, oh, great, you've done good. maybe I won't take the SAT again, but ended up taking it again and did better on that third. So progressively got better because of the support I had in terms of studying more and all of that and understanding the exam better. Because if you take it once, you didn't know what you were walking into. Sometimes you need to give yourself that that follow-up. So that was my introduction.
Okay. All right. So second question is, what encouragement did you have in terms of applying to a variety of schools?
Mm-hmm. Funny, I don't think I needed much encouragement because I am bad at making decisions. So I was like, I need more options. So that was what I was like, I will look for as many schools as possible because I need options. But I think the encouragement I had was from my parents particularly. I think they wanted me to have the ability to make a decision that was best for me. So if you limit your options, you know, some people know exactly where they want to go. And so they applied on, you know, one or two schools, early decision, and then they let it go. For me, I think I had applied to, and this might sound like a lot, but some of them were also the same application. I think it was probably like 18 schools. Some of them were SUNY. So you just kind of send the same application, CUNY, you send the same application, and then a variety of private and separate schools. I think, having a guidance counselor that I got to speak to about understanding what my interests were, what was I looking for in a school? There's thousands of universities, associate degree programs, bachelor programs, but, you know, to really kind of begin to understand what you need or what you're looking for, I started using websites and tools that would just help to like filter. So I started on a mindset of, I have the ability to go to as many as I want, rather than, you know, what are my small little options? What are my limited options? Think, you know, with a mindset of abundance is what I think is important in this process, because you are deserving of any and whatever school you want to go to. So from a mindset of abundance, I started to look at it from, you know, if I have to filter from, let's say 3,000 schools down to eventually one, how do I begin to cut that down so it's a manageable number for me? And that's, you know, where my family and my dad and I really had to talk about making those lists of what am I looking for. So because I was coming from a school that my graduating class was 150, which is very small, I knew maybe going to a huge mega school wasn't the best option for me, because the reason why I felt very much like I had support and success at my high school was because of that one-on-one question you could develop. So I'm one-on-one relationship you could develop there. So I wanted a medium school that would offer more than what my high school could, because there was not a lot of extracurriculars and all that, but also something manageable enough where I felt supported once I got to the university, because I wasn't just one of 20,000, but one of maybe what eventually Duke was 7,000. And so I ended up, again, making those lists. Just be very, it's okay to have your wants. You're not going to be missing out because more schools in. Again, you have so many and you have to choose one. So the more you can really be specific about what you want, if you want a school that has a basketball team, that's D1, like Division I basketball team. That was like, that can help you cut down a lot. And it might seem arbitrary, but if that's what you want, it will help you, because you'll be able to filter down to the one that really, 1, 2, 5, that help to fit your needs. And then when you apply, you have a better chance. So the support for having my dad help me walk through understanding what I was looking for and making that very much like on a list, put pen to paper and write it down so you know what you want. That was very helpful in terms of being able to make a decision that felt informed by something. It wasn't just arbitrary.
Okay. I want to talk about for a second about who you spend your time with and who you hang out with. Mm-hmm. And maybe you could talk, I think some of the young people on here have some interesting choices in terms of who they're hanging with and who they're spending time with and so forth. So maybe you could talk to us a little bit just in terms of the importance of surrounding yourself with supportive people and people who are motivating and just sort of like what that looks like as a young person and what that looked like for you.
Yeah. That's interesting. So yeah, I think, you know, you go to school and you begin to branch out from your family and make your own network of people and friends, and that looks different for everybody. And really, I think when we go to school and we're looking for to be accepted, we're looking for a space to feel welcomed. And so I think, you know, sometimes that isn't always, it's, you know, sometimes it's a very positive environment, sometimes it's not, but it can feel good because you have that support and people who care about you. So I think it's just about being, you know, mindful. For me, again, I went to a very small school. So my whole school community was really like friends. I had many different friend groups, and sometimes that's okay. You can have friends for certain things, right? You can have your friends that you play on a sport with, and that's what you guys are there for. You're there to build like that team mindset and win or whatever. And then you have your friends that you know can support you, and you can be supportive to them in a more academic sense. And so I think even knowing that you don't have to be one type of person, but you should always be choosing people that are pouring into you in a positive way, and that you are also doing that as for them, and not feeling bad about having to cut off people that aren't, or, you know, distance yourself from people that aren't adding positivity to your life, or you are not able to do the same for them. In school, again, I had a variety of different friends that thankfully to this day I'm still friends with, but they're not all friends. They all, you know, they operate in different spaces, and sometimes see some here, sometimes see some there, but knowing that they're all people who have my best interest in mind, and knowing and being, I can be honest about what that best interest is, and there's no hiding who I am, right?
Right, and I mean, the reason why I think that's, you know, if I do say to myself, an interesting question, mm-hmm. Yes. On the back, yes. It's because it doesn't mean that other people are bad or they're like horrible. It just means you might be going in different directions in terms of where your focus is and where their focus is. Mm-hmm. But you have to be very clear about what your focus is, in order to be able to stay on that trajectory. Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Yeah. Let's talk like real talk numbers and so forth. So obviously you went to Duke, so you had some really great grades. What did that look like for you in terms of getting the good grades, what you needed to do that, the focus? And the second part of this question is gonna be, when did you really start focusing on the college process and say to yourself, okay, I got to really sort of focus on this? Because I think we have some students on here as young as about 10, yeah. With his mom, and, you know, as old as like 18. So in between there, you know,
yeah.
The starting point, yeah. Some people yeah. Even earlier than that. Yeah. What was it for you?
Yeah, for me, I've always been like a hard worker. And like, I say that really meaning it, like, sometimes to the point where it's a little ridiculous. So I have to learn what the balance looks like for that. So going into high school is very like excited and like all these, well, I wasn't ever necessarily excited. I didn't love the school that I was going to, but eventually began to love it. But it looked like for me, always putting my best foot forward. Like there wasn't a time where I'm not, and sometimes to a fault, right? Staying up too late, doing projects and working on school assignments that like my family's like, go to sleep. So, you know, entering high school was ambitious to do well. I don't know if it was with the goal of getting into some great school. I didn't know like Duke was gonna be my school. You know, again, I know my parents had dreams of me going to a great college and things of that sort, but it was really just all like, I was doing the work to do well in school for the purpose of like this semester, next semester. Like it wasn't like some lofty goal that like, you know, to do well to get into like Harvard, I need to start doing well from ninth grade. That wasn't really my mindset, but it was just always the mindset of doing your best today for today's purpose. It's never just, you know, again, that's for the end goal of just being my best self today. So yeah, high school came in, again, I think, you know, we had this thing where at the end of every report card session, you would put names on a list, which I don't know if it's a very good thing to do, but it's like publicly shown like where everybody ranks and stuff like that. And it was always, you know, again, in the top area of that list. And that was something that I took pride in eventually, because once, you know, I got to learn what that is, and then my parents are coming in for, you know, parent-teacher conference, that's something I took pride in. So, you know, it was pretty consistent with getting, I don't know if we were doing A's or fours at that four out of, you know, whatever at that time. And took APs, didn't always do the best on those exams. At the end of the day, I just wasn't a great test taker. I think I probably got mostly threes on my APs, which are, you know, it's just an average score. It's not bad, it's not great. I think maybe I got a four once, but that wasn't a determining factor in terms of me getting into school. I think taking the AP was a testament to my ability to want to learn more. Mm-hmm. So, you know, sometimes it's just putting yourself in the right space rather than always excelling at it. I wasn't the one getting, you know, number five on the exam, but because I was taking all that was offered at my school, because we only had about four APs, I think I took about maybe three. You know, it showed that, again, even on my college app, I can talk to them and say, hey, you know, my school didn't offer an abundance of these, but I did take this many of them. It looked like getting involved in clubs that I was interested in. I was on the cheerleading team. It doesn't always have to be an academic thing. You know, it was fun for me. I loved the uniform, so I wanted to be on the team. So so it just looked like getting involved, yeah, like from the jump when I got to high school. And all of those things eventually supported my college application. Again, I don't think I was very always mindful of that. I think my school was about college and career readiness, so they were probably putting that in our minds. But I was very much just intentional about getting involved in things that I thought was interesting, taking leadership roles from freshman year on. Never think you're too young to get involved and be a leader in any program. That always doesn't always look like the president, but that looks like the secretary, and making sure that managing that, you know, all events are and meetings are going well. And then from there, like I said, eventually I ended up taking the AC. So probably junior year, end of junior year, was getting serious about college, I think, if I remember correctly. That was probably the first time I took the SAT. It was maybe spring of junior year. Yes, I think so. And in between that and the end of winter of senior year, I took the two other exams too. So a lot can happen over the summer between your junior and senior year, because then that gives you that time to really know where you stood maybe at that test the first time, what your interests are that you've done over throughout the time in high school, and then how you want that to either translate into college or in the school you go to, or be very different than your high school experience and how you want to get there. I had two brothers, they'd both gone to college, so they were a great resource for me and like understanding what their experience was like. So just talking to people around me about like what they liked and about college. I went on a lot of college tours through my school, thankfully. They had, you know, a couple programs to take me to schools that I didn't necessarily care to go to, but I went to the college campus. I think that was super important, college campus tours, just to understand what the school was like. You know, not because I necessarily wanted to go to American University and think it was in Philly or something, but because I'd never been on a college campus that was, you know, more recent than CSI. So that was really good to, you know, explore that. And see what I like. I went to George Washington University and I realized I don't like DC. Like, I don't want to be in a, as someone who studied public policy, I didn't like the politics. So I didn't want to be there. So
that was the same with me. Yeah. I was like, I love policy.
It's just really great to push yourself out for those who want to go away from home. And I really do encourage those who can, and don't let necessarily finance limit you, because we can talk about that. To do it, because it's really a, like, I learned and grew so much in 4 years being away from home, that you just may not be able to. It will look very different if you are home and you are commuting and all that. So I knew off the bat that I needed to, and I wanted to go away just for school and live away from home. And thankfully had the support of my parents. And that's a hard decision and hard conversation to have with your 17-year-old. But again, thankfully I was the third child, so there was a little bit more leniency than maybe if you're the first child.
More flexibility.
And then also I want to say I did take college courses at CSI number of times throughout my high school career. And I think that's a great thing. If there's college readiness now, or college access now is what it was called or something, take those classes. You know, again, it's not always about the grade you get at the end, but always about how much you're applying yourself. And don't push yourself to be where you're juggling too much all the time and overwhelmed all the time, because I think that was me at some points. But it's about, you know, doing actively trying to test your limit a little bit and see what, you know, what more, what you can take on and what you should let go of too after you've done something for a little while. Yeah. I don't know if that answered your question.
Yes, it did. All right. I'm going to just ask a couple more questions. And then if you have questions, please put them in the chat or you can take yourself off mute. So I'm going to just ask a couple more questions. Mm-hmm. So one, you talked about AP classes. Yes. And you mentioned that you went to a school where they didn't have a ton of offerings, but you basically, you took this many and you told the schools, I took this many, this is what I could take. Can you just talk a little bit about if you're at a school and maybe they don't have a ton of AP classes, what you can do, how you can navigate that?
Yeah. So I think, yeah, like I said, I think CSI had, I took AP Calc, English, and Government or something. And then there was definitely like a language one you could have taken, and maybe one more. So max, it was about five at the time. So it's really important to be very, I think, vulnerable and honest on these applications, because again, you're competing with a lot of students, like a lot. And that's not to scare you, but it's the honest truth. And so I think where there are some kids who off paper and looking at their numbers and this and what they've got involved in, they're like, oh, this is an amazing student and blah, blah, blah. But when you can see that someone is resilient in the face of limited resources and applies themselves in the face of limited resources, it speaks to your character more than just your ability to be good at certain things, right? So even if, you know, AP Calc wasn't gonna be my most exciting class and something I didn't really want to do because I didn't love math at that point. I loved math up until like algebra and geometry. And then afterwards it just started getting hysterical. But I was like, you know what? This will put me in a better space to look good on these applications. And so I took the class. I find my supportive group of friends, right? So you might have your AP friends that really help you and each other to support each other through that process, because it's not always easy. And I won't deny that. And then also relying on your teachers and being honest with them about where you are throughout the class. But yeah, so I was on my applications and you just be very honest, maybe even asking your guidance counselor who's helping you, if they're helping you through this process, to write letters. Sometimes I think they could probably add maybe just like commentary on what the school environment is like, to be like, oh, our school only offers XYZ, because these colleges won't do the research for you. They're not going to always be able to look into what your school offers, what it doesn't offer. So you have to tell them that. Yeah, I think either my guidance counselor wrote, you know, maybe a letter to just say what the school sort of academic offering was, or I think maybe, you know, I even just put it in my own or added in a statement to just explain that, you know, again, my school is small. It's only opened 8 years ago. And so, you know, it's a school that's focused on college and career readiness and bettering the students in whatever they have to offer, but it's not a school that has everything. And there's obviously language we could probably find online about how to frame this sort of thing, just to let them be transparent. But transparency throughout this process is going to be helpful, because then it will just, like, again, it will allow you to tell them that, but I was very much active and proactive in getting involved in what there was to offer and what was of interest to me there. And I then maybe if it wasn't APs, I went and took classes at the college because that was more interesting to me at the time. And because they conflicted with the AP schedule, I couldn't do those. You know, whatever your story is, just let them know. Because sometimes you do have to make a decision and it's not fun. Maybe you wanted to take an AP and the college class and it just wouldn't have worked. Let them know that, you know, I think there's space for that.
Okay. And then resume, mm-hmm. The importance of a resume. I have students age 9 that are working on resumes with us. Okay, I know. But hey,
it's good. It's good.
Early than late, right?
Yes.
Maybe you could talk to us a little bit about why are resumes important? Why should we care? And maybe 9 is a little early.
Yes. I applaud that one.
He starts. He wanted to start early, but just talk to us a little bit about why is it important for a high school student to have a resume, and how can a resume help you in terms of the college process?
Mm-hmm. Resumes are things you will be working on for the rest of your life.
Yes.
I think what day was it? Thursday night. was sitting there working on my resume with a mentor that is now helping me to understand what, you know, language I should be using to better explain my skill sets, the things I've placed myself in, like what responsibilities to take on. So you will always need a resume for the rest of your life. And it is very difficult sometimes, particularly when you're gonna only have one page to do it, and myself still, to, you know, at some point it seems daunting because you have this whole page. It's like, how do I fill it up with stuff? But you're doing so many things, right? If you are working at your local cafe 2 times a week and learning how to communicate with new customers all the time, that's a skill, right? And so a resume helps you, one, document all the things that you have been doing from high school on. So I have a master one, right? I have a big master resume that's probably like 4 pages right now that has everything from when I was in high school. And it helps you to really remember what you've been doing. Sometimes you think you're going to remember the thing you did freshman year, spring, so like once you got into school, you won't remember it. By the time senior year comes around, you're going to be like pulling for things. And it's going to be so hard for you to be like, when they ask you a question on this, like, when was the time that you took on a leadership role? And your last leadership role maybe was your sophomore year of, or the one you really want to talk about was your sophomore year of high school, but you don't really remember what role that was or what tasks you did. And they want details, and details are what's going to make you stand out. And so I think the resume today will help you to, you know, in the future, feel very prepared, feel ready to talk about yourself, because talking about yourself can be difficult, but it's not as hard when you have the details there to pull from. So I think the resume, even it kind of could look like a journal for you right now. Journal down the things you've done, journal down the programs you've helped facilitate, write down what you did. Did you send 15 emails to a community, you know, organization that you guys now partnered with to facilitate a food drive in your school during the time of COVID? Like, if you did that, that is really important, because not only did you just say that you helped facilitate a food drive, but write down the specific thing that you did, or the specific way that you did, with a team of only 4 students, a team of 15 students, a team of 30 students, however many. Use those specific details, because I don't think a lot of us, because it wasn't me, are thinking in the mindset of how do I be as detailed about my life and what I'm doing right now. It will really, really help you in the future. And it will showcase that you are very conscious of the work that you're doing, and it'll help you. So I think resumes are really important. Formatting them and all that can be very daunting, and that's a whole nother task. But I think if you get the details down on paper, just throughout your high school experience, even if it's every, at the end of every semester, take the time. I know you're exhausted and all that. Take the time to do 30 minutes of journaling all the things that you did related to, you know, putting yourself out there outside of your regular, you know, classes and things. But like, you know, were you a tutor for local kids and you helped some kid accomplish XYZ? Like, write that down, because you never know what it will tie back to in the future, and what you might need to speak on it about. So that's what the point of the resume is. It's just to be a reference point, and one day to showcase all the things you've done and show them that you are capable of juggling multiple things based on like what you were doing at the same time, because you'll put the dates there too. So it'll help them to show like you're always in an extracurricular. They'll say that, oh, this person gets themselves involved. So I think, yeah, resumes are really helpful. They are daunting sometimes. I still like have the edits that I need to go back and make now based on, you know, and they're always evolving, and that's a beautiful thing, even if it can be frustrating. So I definitely encourage everybody to write down consistently the things you're getting yourself involved in and what those specific tasks, titles, make up, you know, if you don't always have a title for it, you know, kind of figure out what is that title. Were you an assistant to a teacher when they were planning the senior trip? You know, like, write those things down, because they will you underestimate how much they'll help you. They really will.
Okay, 2 more questions from me, and then we'll see if anybody else has questions. Mm-hmm. College interviews and college essays.
Okay.
You have words of advice for students regarding the college essay and the college interview.
Like I said, I applied to maybe 17 or 18 schools. Again, I think how we had planned it was like kind of my secure ones, the ones that I'd probably get into, the ones that are a little bit reach, or things that are in my range, but maybe a little, you know, higher than my SAT or all these, like, kind of just assessing based on what their previous acceptance rate looked like. And then my real reach, like Harvard, Stanford, again, my parents would not let me, like, they didn't care what grades I had, like, you were going to apply there just for the sake of saying you applied there. So ultimately didn't get into those two, but that was, again, it's the process is, it's make it as fun, even if it's stressful, as possible. You might have a reach school where it's like, ooh, this is a little bit out of my range. Do not limit yourself, because you saying no before they say no has already closed the door. If you leave the door open, you never know what about you will be the difference they're looking for. If you are a violin player, piano player, and they've, like, never had a piano player from Staten Island before, maybe they want that. You don't know what they're looking for. Don't be the no that, you know, to the schools, because, but again, also set yourself up for success. So maybe apply for those ones that, you know, even if I didn't get into all my reach schools, I'd be happy here. And I know I could get in here with what my grades and stuff present. As it comes to essays, and so I got probably, I think I did like maybe 4 interviews, one being Duke. And they can be a little nerve-wracking, you know, again, never having to talk to someone that, you know, is one, has some sort of influence on this, but also on, they're just a person you don't know. So you have to have that conversation. But I think the best way to prepare for interviews is, one, knowing your story. So sometimes even for jobs, right, you should go in knowing what you want them to leave knowing about you. Regardless of what question they ask you, there's no question that you couldn't weave a certain story into it. So if I wanted them to know that I'm Nigerian American, my dad was born in London, so I grew up with a global perspective, right? Let's just say that's what I wanted to talk about. And this school is very much focused on global education. And I think I might want to study global education, right? Or global, you know, which is ultimately global health. That is what I'm going in knowing I'm going to talk about, and knowing that it connects to both my family and stuff, but also maybe a program or something that I've done in high school now. Go in knowing what you want them to know about you, that you know, not only, you know, your high school team was a basketball all-state or this or that, but that, you know, you helped to really, you know, shape the mindset of being very positive for your team. Go in knowing what you think you want them to know about you that will reflect well on why you think you'd be a good fit for the school. Because then you can answer any question weaving that in. And I think that makes you feel confident because you have some sort of like grounding and like, okay, I know what language I'll be using today. And it's not robotic, but it will be like sort of like that. Do the research on the school, right? So you got to know, why would you want to go there? Because that's really what they're trying to feel from you, is not only what your interest is, do they think personality wise you'd be happy there? This is a time also for you to learn about them. So have questions prepared, always have questions. And these could be like, hey, you know, what was your, the highs and lows of your experience at Duke University, so that they can give you the honest truth, so you know what sort of decision you're making. You're not only there to sell yourself to them in terms of like why you belong at the school, but why they want you. You know, are they a supportive school campus? Do you need certain things and you want to know if they have it that you couldn't find online? Always do research so that you can know what is online already. You don't really have to ask those certain questions. But yeah, the interviews can either help you figure out if you want to go to a school or if you don't. But know what sort of, I think the best thing about that is just know what you want them to leave knowing about you and the type of person you are, and be on time.
Be on time.
The most basic thing, be on time, be early, honestly. Right.
Well, better yet, show up. I've done college interviews and students haven't shown up. So show up.
If there's an emergency, don't just later on tell them no. Tell them ahead of time. So the basic things are really show up, you know, be excited, you know, have some good questions, ask other people, maybe test it out with your friends at school. Like, hey, if I asked you this, do you think that sounds like, you know, or ask your guidance counselor. Just be prepared. Do a little bit of the work ahead of time. Doesn't have to be, don't run yourself into the ground. Prepare. It will be an organic conversation and they want to see you succeed. But yeah, that's how I prepared for that. And then lastly, what did you ask again? Oh, the essay. Oof. Yeah. The essays are difficult because it's also, you know, again, reading the prompt. first is all what I say. Read the prompt, understand the question they're asking you. And again, understand what you want them to know about you. So don't just start writing to write, write to know what you want at the end of the day, answer this question and them leave knowing about what type of person you are, what your life experiences have been. And I think this is a great time to showcase just you as a person and your personality and your lived experiences. It doesn't always have to be an academic, you know, related experience. I think mine was very personal about family and, my sister and our relationship and what that meant, to push myself to really connect with her, and just a lot of different things that were very personal. And sometimes that's difficult to write. And it was probably many drafts later that I, submitted. In some schools, you have to write multiple personal essays. So I think just think back on some of your life experiences. They don't have to be super traumatic or dramatic. I think sometimes we read about these ones online and it's all very like the hardest thing.
I went through the Sahara Desert at age 2 and I made it after 18 years. And then I walked into college after that. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And that's, and again, sometimes, unfortunately, I think some of the schools don't help you to report, like, understand that you are I was a very like, I'm privileged to live a very normal life, if I want to be honest. Right. Like, I didn't have a lot of very normal, but there are things that I want to talk about that like really developed me. That could be going to Nigeria at a young age and, not being able to speak the language there and, feeling that little disconnect. And what does that mean for me as a person who's Nigerian and claims that, but doesn't really know, how to speak the language and that, and what does that mean about language and your culture and all that and identity? Again, it's not the super most dramatic story. I'm not saying anything, but I'm talking about who I am and why that mattered to me, that I wanted to speak the language there, but also that, my family history and all that. So like that could be that, right? There are people who are gonna have very resilient stories, but again, find what makes you you. Some people write funny stories, right? And they know that the college that they want to go to has an environment where that is welcomed, right? And it's a very place where that their personality will be supported and that they want to join Duke's comedy club and whatever. And that's something that they could not find at any other school to support a kid both academically, but also in their interest, in their personality as a comedian, and that they performed in front of their school for this white thing. And then, whatever. That's something you probably wouldn't have had on your resume. It's something you wouldn't have had on your, college app, but because you can write it on it and they can see your personality, and they need every type of student. There is no one type of student that is going to be replicated to make a school environment great. So just be authentic, be detailed, and try and find a story that you think really represents who you are as a person. It will be difficult, but find a good buddy to read it, your guidance counselor, tell them to be honest. Always look for honesty when people are reading your stuff. So.
Okay, and we actually have a question from the audience. So this is from Crystal, and she says, what advice do you have for financial aid, and what would your advice be for students who are stressed out?
Yes.
About the college process, because it can get stressful, can it, Sasanji? It can get very stressful. So financially, we're going to actually have a whole session. And by the way, you're welcome to come back to any of these. We would love you to come back again. So you and I will talk.
Yes.
Love for you to come back. I think the financial aid question, we can't answer in 30 seconds, but feel free to give it a quick whirl.
Yeah.
And then the stress, I'm interested in that too. So stress and financial aid, keeping in mind, we will do a deep dive on financial aid. Our next session, doing no small measure through a wonderful PowerPoint that our student Annie put together as well. So we will have that available. So financial aid and stress in 2 minutes or less.
The funny thing is that those were probably like financial aid and being stressed.
Let the stress.
Very much tied to my experience.
It's a causation and a correlation
of my stress. So it was not easy. I think for me, like I said, I went to Duke University, which was the first, I never went to private school. I never paid private school money. I went to a free public high school. One of my brothers even went to a private school, but they brought him home because it was just too much money at that point. And at that point, the financial aid was okay, but it wasn't great. So I understand very much so what that means. And I took the leap of going to a private school, knowing I was getting, you know, if I'm being honest, I think the school at that time was about maybe 65K a year, which is a lot of money over 4 years after you pay that, you know, and I was probably getting maybe half of that in financial aid. That was stressful because half sounds great, but you know, that's another 30K left on the table. And how do you figure that out with two parents who, again, I'm lucky to have two parents, but they're working civil servant jobs. We're not millionaires, you know? Yeah. So I applied for financial aid, always do it. I don't care if you have, you know, what that looks like if you can. I know that's not always afforded to everybody, but if you can apply for financial aid, they will, you know, the government will either provide you with grants, which are always what you want. Always look for grants because that's money you don't have to pay back. Whereas loans, even if it's a good interest rate, all that stuff, you still have to pay it back eventually. I knew where I wanted to go. I was a little hard-headed and I said, I'm going to Duke. And my parents were like, okay, you're gonna go to Duke then. Financial aid for a lot of people, and I think for most, unless you know, you're below a certain level, will only cover portions of your school. So that's where the scholarship is really key. That scholarships both in the school that are not always just afforded to everyone, you have to look for them. So certain programs that you might want to apply for that might help you shape your decision too. I think financial aid is helpful in, you know, shaping a decision about what schools to go to. Look at what packages the schools are offering and then go back to them and say, you know, hey, is there any other things I can apply for? Start asking questions. Just ask as many questions, ask as many people. Is there anything else I can apply for to better make this in a more affordable experience for me if I were to come here? Because I want to come here, but I can't afford it at this price. Be honest, they're not going to not let you come to the school because of that. Look for scholarships. It's hard. You're going to be tired after applying, but look for scholarships and apply. The smaller ones are great. I know people that have gotten the Coca-Cola ones that carry them for 4 years and all that, like do it all. Like, I know it's not gonna be fun, but you would rather have your tuition paid by somebody else than have to have yourself and your parents pay for it. So financial aid, it could be a little tricky about learning how to actually do that like initial process, but look to your guidance counselor, go ask them. I think New York City might have a free resource on certain things like that as well. There might be a counselor that you can kind of like tap into through the city for free about just like finances and stuff. And if I find that, I'll send it over to Heather. But scholarships are gonna be your best bet. Really, that's all I know for people. Like scholarships and grants are free money. That's what you want. You don't want loans. I have them. I'm paying them. I'm going to be honest. I'm going to be paying them. And I'm now living at home. So I get to pay them as if I was paying rent. I've used like, let's say I lived on my own and I was paying rent. I take that and my mindset has now been, that's the type of money I'm putting away to pay off my loans. And that's being honest. And you don't want to be that person if you don't have to. Again, I would never take back my Duke education, but whatever, you know, you got to pay for it now. I'd rather have somebody else had paid for it.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Somebody else who didn't have to worry about to. Yeah, exactly. And by the way, there are people out there that can do that. Scholarships and grants are those inanimate people.
Yes. There are local organizations. Look to local orgs that are, say, ask them, are you guys have any scholarships going on too? Doesn't always have to be the big ones.
Right. And also, you know, your parents, your family members, it might be have jobs that have grants, that have scholarships. Yes. A lot of that stuff goes unclaimed because people don't realize, oh, my job has scholarships for, you know, college for my child. So that's available too.
And lastly, for stress, again, there's not going to be a short answer for this either, but I think you begin to limit your stress when you know what you want, right? So that's why you could be stressed about, there's so many choices. I was stressed that way, but not when you know who you want and what you want, right? So if you start to know what you want, then now you only have 20 choices, and I'm going to let that not be a stress anymore because I have 20. That's what I want. Let that go. Check it off and stop thinking about that. Now it's like, how do I make one of those 20s my school? So it's like really just pen to paper is really what's going to help you here. If you start to write down the things you want, how you get there task by task, maybe write down next to it who you're going to look to for help on that specific issue so that you know you have a community. It's not just a you doing this thing. Again, there are going to be stressful times when you have to get over the SATs, and that's going to be the thing. But like, do you have a friend that you know you can rely on, that you guys will be studying together every week until the SAT? Build the community for each different thing that you got to do, and know that there will be people to support you along the way if you find the right group, because that's, you can't carry it all on your own. You shouldn't have all the answers because you're going through this for the first time, but there are people who have gone through it before, like myself, who you can call upon, who want to be there to help you. And you have to be able to relinquish that and let people help you think through things. And then when you've thought through it and you've made a decision on it, let it go, because you can't keep carrying all the stress of every single next step along the way, or else it will become a burden. And you know, you're going to be juggling your regular classes. You're going to be juggling home life. You might have to help a sibling now that COVID, like, let, you know, be honest, just like, you know, with yourself and with the people around you that, you know, I really need help with this. I really need help with that. And stress, just know that at the end of the day, when it's all said and done, if you're, you know, along the process, being very honest about what type of school you want to go to and what, you know, you're looking for, you will be like, I was so joyous when I got into Duke and I knew that this is where I was going to go. And I knew this was like, I had applied myself for the, like, the school that I wanted to be at. There's nothing that anyone can take away from you after that. So the stress is going to come. It's a part of life, but it's more manageable when you build a network for each step along the way. And it will look like different people along the way.
I love it. Yeah. All right. So thank you to everybody who was here. I also want to thank our student Megan, who had to run to another session, but she's from the Williamsburg High School, a fabulous school that Executive Superintendent Watts was talking about in the beginning, the Williamsburg High School for Architecture and Design. So thank her for coming. And of course, all kudos and thanks to the fabulous and amazing Satanji Agosa for being here with us and giving all her words of wisdom. I hope she will join us again.
Yes, you have
to be here. Awesome. So we will definitely have her back, put her email in the chat. Mm-hmm. Huge thank you. And thank you to everybody who was here today and listened in. We will be back next month for another edition of the monthly College Readiness. Yes. And we hope to see you all back here again.
Yes.
Thank you, everybody. And thank you, Sanji. Anything else you want to tell before we sign off?
No, just like, hey, good for you for getting up at 10 a.m. You are showing yourself to be, you know, that you're putting yourself in the best position possible. Not that, you know, anyone, there's a lot of things that come up with people's life, but anytime you can attend things like this and just put yourself in a position to learn more information and get a new resource, you're doing yourself justice. So that's all.
Thank you. All right. We'll see everybody next month. Thanks a lot. Right. Bye.